this is Robert Stephenson's 1829 rocket. I'm Darren, and this is the Industrial Revolution. Built for the Rainhill Trials, and we'll talk about those more in a minute, Rocket introduced a huge number of innovations that pretty much every subsequent steam locomotive would end up adopting. Let's take a look at what some of those are. One of the first things you notice as you approach Rocket is that unlike pretty much every other steam locomotive you've ever seen, it's a 022 locomotive. It has only two drive wheels and two trailing wheels. Typically there were four or more on locomotives before and after Rocket. Due to the conditions on the Rainhill trial, Stephenson realized that he didn't really need the extra tractive force from the extra wheels, and he'd be able to get by with just two. And that actually helped a great deal. Next thing you're going to notice is these pistons that run diagonally. Now, if you think diagonal pistons are weird, you should see what came before them. Prior to Rocket, steam pistons on locomotives were actually vertical. And that created a problem if they went very quick, which is that it would cause the locomotive to rock back and forth, potentially violently rock back and forth. That's hard on the gear, it's hard on the rail bed, it's hard on the people on the train. So setting them at an angle like this actually resolved a big part of that problem. Another thing you'll notice is off of the piston, we have what's called a blast pipe. The blast pipe connects from the piston down under the locomotive and connects into the smokestack. Running the steam through the smokestack, which pretty much all subsequent locomotives did, ends up creating a huge pull upward, and that draws more air into the firebox. The firebox then can burn hotter, and you can get more efficiency from your fuel. And speaking of the firebox, let's take a look at that. So the previous locomotives ran a firebox or simply ran a flue-type boiler. In this case, this firebox is actually a two-layer boiler with a water jacket. So you'd catch the radiant heat from the fire, as well as then catching the convective heat as you run the flue gases through the boiler itself. And although we can't see it here, the boiler was also a multi-tube boiler, which was actually just invented 1 year sooner, in 1828. And it was one of the first locomotives to use a multi-tube boiler. Pretty much all subsequent locomotives did use that. So let's talk about the Rainhill trials and the reason that they were around in the first place. When locomotives were first built, it was all about freight. In fact, even beyond that, it was all about really mining. They took mining steam engines, the Newcomen engines, the Watt engines that were used in mines, and used them to propel locomotives, which could then tow the extremely heavy cars full of coal and stone and different mining ores, and that's what they were for. So obviously they were designed for maximum tractive power. They were designed to maximize the amount of weight they could pull, and that came with some trade-offs. Now, from the beginning though, people wanted to ride as well. But when you have people riding trains instead of cargo riding trains, your expectations are different. You start to care about speed, you start to care about time, you start to care about reliability, being on time, being able to maintain a schedule. And really at that point, you're starting to get an entirely different kind of locomotion, an entirely different kind of train experience. An experience very much like this one. So the Rainhill trials were set up as a way to actually create a passenger train specific locomotive. Everything before that was focused on freight trains. So what were the rules for the Raintree trial? Well,
They're pretty straightforward. Since it was designed as to find passenger trains, not freight, they wanted high speed, high reliability. They did not, in fact, need anything even close to being high power. If you had a two-axle system, it could be 4.5 tons. If it was three axles, it could be up to 6 tons maximum. And the maximum train weight would not exceed 3 times the locomotive weight, which was extremely light. So you really had to focus on fast and light. The day of the event, you would fire up your boiler, and as soon as your boiler hit 50 PSI, the clock started. You'd go out an eighth of a mile to speed up. After you'd gone the eighth of a mile, you'd go 1.5 miles at full speed, and then you'd come back down eighth of a mile to come back to a stop. So you had 1.75 miles each direction. You made that trip 10 times back and forth. Your total average speed had to be at least 10 miles per hour. If it wasn't 10 miles per hour, you were disqualified. At the end of that 10 times, you were allowed to refuel, add water, and go again. Now, the way it was timed is you were timed for the total travel time on both of your trips, and you were timed for the total refueling and resupply time in the middle. And that combination would determine the winner of the Raintree Trials. So the Raintree Trials in 1829 were created to develop a brand new kind of locomotive. And when they finally happened, only 5 locomotives actually showed up. On the other hand, they had 10 to 15,000 spectators every day. They had live music, had vendors, they had food. It was a circus. It was a party atmosphere. But then it was time for the 5 locomotives to actually go out and compete. So the first competitor was Cycloped. Cycloped was not exactly what you'd think of as a normal locomotive. Cycloped was, in fact, a horse on a treadmill, and the treadmill drove the wheels. Now, horse mills like that had existed before, but for some reason on this one, the horse actually broke through the belt, destroying the Cycloped, and Cycloped was disqualified on the first run. That led us up to the second competitor. The second competitor was Perseverance. Perseverance was actually damaged in transit. It was not able to run the first day. It did run the second day. It did not, however, achieve a 10 mile per hour average, and consequently, it was also disqualified. The third competitor was Sanspareil. Sanspareil came in 300 pounds overweight. Not only that, it was allowed to compete, but despite being 300 pounds overweight, it still cracked a cylinder during the event. So it was disqualified. Fourth competitor was Novelty. Novelty was a crowd favorite. Everyone thought Novelty was the one that was going to win. Novelty achieved a 28 mile per hour maximum speed before it damaged a boiler pipe on the first day. On the second day, they were able to fix the boiler pipe sort of temporarily. On the second day, it achieved a 15 mile per hour speed before it had some severe damage. And after receiving that damage, they had to drop out of the competition as well. Things weren't going well, and then it was Rocket's turn. Rocket was actually the only competitor to finish the Rainhill Trials. Rocket averaged 12 miles per hour, including all the stops, and achieved a top speed of 30 miles per hour. And of course, being the only one to finish, Rocket received the contract. So there's some great stories about the Rainhill Trials. I'll tell you a couple of them. Let's say that Stephenson was very self-confident. I suppose that's a polite term for it. In between the races, Stephenson would hook up passenger cars and would take people out for rides. Now, many people at the Rainhill Trials had never even seen a steam train before, so being given the opportunity to go out on a ride, that was incredible. Another thing that Stephenson did, I mentioned these other 4 had actually broken down. When they broke down, Stephenson would go out on the tracks, hook up to them, and tow them back for them, along with the cars that were attached. I don't know how modest he was about it, but he did it, and it really did show just how good the rocket design was. Unfortunately, if you went out looking for a rocket today, you might have some trouble finding it. Oh, it still exists. It's an incredibly famous locomotive. No one's going to turn that one into scrap metal. It's currently located in the Locomotion Museum in Sheldon, in England. Unfortunately, though, it's been so modified that you'd walk right by it. In fact, in the first year, it received so many modifications that people said that you would not recognize it. The really unique diagonal pistons and cylinders, those were made horizontal. The distinct flame tube boiler, that size was actually doubled to provide more steam. And they made countless other changes. And in the end, you wouldn't recognize it anymore. However, despite all that, Rocket really is the Industrial Revolution. Anyway, I do need your help to keep this channel going. If you've enjoyed the video, please hit like and subscribe. Also, I do have a Patreon page over at patreon.com/industrialrevolution if you could help out there. This channel obviously involves a lot of travel to come out and see stuff like this. So if you could help me out, I'd appreciate that. Memberships start at just a few bucks a month.